So I was asked, as I was here, to give this talk. This is a talk then that I did about a month ago on essentially microelectronic engineering education. So it's the idea then of carving the perfect engineer. What does it take to make a perfect engineer, or the ideal engineer? And the wording, it's a funny title, and I'm not overly happy with it, but nevertheless, I can see in hindsight why I titled it like that. I mean, I want to introduce myself as a grey-haired design engineer, okay? Because I am still a design engineer, and I'm one of those guys who persisted with an interest in the technology as opposed to went down other avenues. And so it's interesting, because the grey hair is starting to get inside, and so the grey matter inside is probably white, if you could see it now. So this whole thing is getting in that way. And so I'm actually approaching retirement, and I'm now semi-retired. But the thing that interested me in this was, in many respects, I'm a design engineer at the finishing line, and the people I was talking to, or people I was referring to, were design engineers at the starting line. And it's interesting then to look at what being an electronic design engineer was when I started relative to what it is now, and the things that have gone through in between. Now, in many respects, I'm an example of being a poor engineer, because I left school at 15 with no qualifications. But the major point about that is 1964, because that date will come back, because that's when I started out on this route. But I took an electronic apprenticeship, and I did a day release, and then after some time I went to Vera Backdoor, went into the University of Swansea in 1970, and eventually graduated, which is where most people who'd be coming out or starting this thing would be. And so it was 1974, which is the other key date on that, because that's when I started then being an electronic design engineer. And I started in a company which is now well gone, a company called PyTMC. And to give some idea about what electronics was in those days, it was mostly professional. There was very little electronics in the home. TV, transistor radio, four-function calculator. That was about it. Four-function calculator would have cost you getting on a week's wages. So these were not cheap things, any of them. Valves. The TV was still valves. Transistor radio, I knew every transistor in my radio by name. There was a mixer, there was a front end, there was two IFs, there was a preamp, and there was the push-pull audio amplifier. That's what the transistors were. They had names. And there was a 7-transistor radio and a 5-transistor radio, and you know, mine was a 7, and I knew the differences between them. This was the sort of electronics that I was coming out into a world of. I mean, in the company we had one computer. It had a power of about 1 MIP, and it was shared. That was the entire design space that we had. Ours was an innovative company, that we were actually designing integrated circuits, but they weren't complex by any of today's measures. But that's the way that you did your design. You were sitting at this teletype terminal, and the paper tape here was the memory part of it. You wrote on the paper tape, and when you wanted to submit your job to be batch processed, then you sent the tape rolled up with an elastic band around the outside of it, and it ran through the computer, and the output was a paper tape. And you looked at the output on a teletype. You know, this is pretty basic stuff. But we were designing four-phase dynamic integrated circuits using that technique. There was no simulation to speak of. We were putting networks together on this thing. There was no graphical user interface or anything of that nature. And a lot of the design analysis, let's call it simulation, was by eye. You looked at it, you convinced yourself, you presented it to your peers, you told them what every gate was doing, and they said, have you thought about this, have you thought about that? And you went through effectively design auditing. The question was, though, when I came out of university in 1974, was I adequately prepared for my next 42 years as a design engineer? And that's what I'm going to look at, because 42 years later I'm still a design engineer. So what was magic about what I'd done. So a little bit then of a bit more detail about just what it was like back then, because it's, you know, this is a real life, I'm a real person, this is not history, this is not ancient history, this is my experience. That's what a telephone looked like. That's what the entire circuit diagram of that is. There is no electronics in there at all. There's a very clever transformer, there's a resistor, there's a couple of lights, you can't see them, I can't see them at the moment. There was a moving comm earpiece, and there was a carbon microphone. The carbon microphone was a capsule full of finely ground carbon dust, which is squeezed by the air pressure, and its resistance varied. I mean, that's the level of technology that we were talking about. This phone, incidentally, was in production for nearly 20 years. Can you imagine a phone, any product, being in production run for 20 years? Today, you can't. This here, I love. That mechanism is the way that the pulses, the 0 to 9 pulses that you dialed when you turned around the dial, were converted into line breaks. Just a very mechanical system. And of course, those things over here, you know what bells sound like? Well, those are real bells. It's interesting how bells are still one of the most favourite ringing tones that people have on their phones. That was my car. That was the entire entire circuit diagram for it. Not the first page, nothing else like that. No electronics in there at all. You can see everything. All the components are there. That was my transistor radio. That's the 7 transistors whose names I know. And I was very proud of that. I could design them, incidentally. I knew how to do it. One thing that stands out from this is that design engineering is really about making stuff happen. And when I went out there into the real world, I realised that I was interested in electronics, but I kept getting distracted by bosses who were saying, yes, 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 it's getting it out that counts. You know, do this, do that, do the other, get this thing, finish this thing, do this thing by then, manage the cost. It was all stuff about delivery. And it was really irritating because it got in the way of my enjoyment. I was enjoying doing this. That's the reason I joined. That's the reason I became an electronic engineer. It was great. But of course, there was the economical aspects of this. For me to enjoy what I was doing, I had to deliver something which had some economic value. Otherwise, nobody's going to pay for me to be in that job. So it's got to work, it's got to be economical, it's got to be reproducible, it's got to be innovative, as well as as well as being fun. It had to achieve all of those things. Now, the criteria for all of those varied hugely. When I first started working, I was working on equipment which was going to go into telephone exchanges. To make the old Strouger equipment, which was electromechanical, to make it electronic. Quite different criteria than today. The volumes were tens of thousands, that's all. The unit itself was big. You could pick it up. It got hot. But it had to survive for 10 or so years in continuous use all day. So there was a collection of characteristics about that which I had to meet, and I met it using the technology that I had available for the day. So I couldn't use 1 micron CMOS because it wasn't invented then, but I could use 1,000 micron technology, which was NMOS, PMOS becoming NMOS, which needed 24 volts power supply and used 4-phase dynamic, because that was the only technology that I could have to bring the necessary capabilities to these products that were being accelerated by the use of electronics. I'm thinking about it in this sense because these are, when I look back, this is the thing which is obvious to me. At the time, I didn't think of it like this at all. It was just a case of, I was doing what my boss told me to do. I was essentially delivering a promise for the future. So I can do this thing, boss, is what I'm saying. You're trusting me to do this thing, I can do it. So I'm offering certainty, I'm offering timescales. I'm offering that the thing that will be produced is actually manufacturable. And I'm offering quality. These are abstract concepts, but they're nevertheless part of that product. There's no point in me delivering the product if it fails after a day. It's inadequate quality. It's no use in me delivering this product if it can't be manufactured. It yields poorly, or it's too complex and it costs a fortune to make. Or if the timescales are a year later than when it's actually required by the market. Or the uncertainty, well, you know, I said I was going to be confident to get it there. Well, I was wrong. You know, what of it? No, it's not good enough. Business is out of business if you're wrong. So it's not just about the pursuit of personal excitement or challenges or pleasure or career. In fact, it's not about those at all. Those are things that you do out of this career. It's not what business wants out of it. So, I'm going to go back even before my time. Antikythera. Hipparchus, 100 BC, probably the first computer. Nobody knows absolutely for sure. It's not a computer as in a stored program computer, it's a computer as in solving equations. And the equations that it was solving, we know, are the equations of motions, particularly about the planets. So this guy, Hipparchus, came up with the concept of a machine to predict basically the positions of the planets and the moon for navigational or ceremonial purposes. We're not really sure. The point is that he had this concept and he created it. But you think about the challenge, 100 BC, of creating that thing. Metals, where were they? How do you process them? How could you make a gear? You don't have any machinery to make the gears. This thing would have had to have been assembled, created pretty well by hand. They look to me like rivets. Like you couldn't even get a big enough piece of metal to cut the wheel out of it. You actually had to rivet bits and pieces together. It was a proof of a concept. Probably only tens were ever made, far too expensive for general use. It was a concept rather than a product, but it was way ahead of its time. So far ahead of its time, in fact, that it wasn't until 1700 that Graham produced the orrery, which is essentially a different implementation of the same computing algorithm. But this was a product. It was actually possible to create this thing on a regular basis using the technologies which were available in that day. 1,800 years between the first concept and the product. Okay, it's a difference between, I mean, the science was solved by Hipparchus 100 BC. The product didn't make it to market till 1700. You know, that's 1,800 years later. So you could say it was a concept way ahead of its time, because I don't think any of the things that we've proposed in the meantime are that far ahead of their time. Yes. Maybe. So Babbage's difference engine, most of you will have heard of this thing, but again, here was a mechanism for computing polynomial tables. Polynomial tables, for those of you who never had to use them, and again, when I started in engineering, we used tables. We used tables and we used slide rules. They were genuine use tools because you didn't have convenient alternatives. Tables just made calculation of complex equations viable. You could do it in a reasonable time, but they weren't absolutely accurate, because it didn't matter that you were absolutely accurate. What mattered was that your bridge actually spanned the gap, not that it was exactly a certain length, and that it was strong enough, not that it was exactly a certain strength. So tables were very useful in an engineering context, and Babbage had this idea for producing a machine for calculating the tables. They used to use ladies, rooms full of ladies, because ladies were precise enough and mature enough not to be distracted. Men are far too easily distracted and immature. And so the word computing comes from these ladies. They were called computers. And that's what they did. They worked out painfully the exponents associated with these numbers by hand. Anyway, Babbage had this wonderful idea, and it was technically possible, but it was way beyond the capability of the machine tools at that time to implement it. Got PDFs, you'll have PDFs of the whole thing, so don't worry about it. It was a product ahead of its time. Now, interestingly, it wasn't the case of it was ahead of its time and was subsequently replaced by or was subsequently implemented by. The need for this thing went away before it ever became a product viable alternative. I mean, this one was implemented in 2000, not because anybody needed it, but because they wanted to prove that Babbage's original description, if he had met the specifications, would have actually worked. And it did. Amsler's planimeter, on the other hand, is a wonderful example of a product which was able to be made from the technology available at the time. Now, it's solving a fairly complex looking equation. What it's trying to do is to work out the area contained within an arbitrary two-dimensional shape. If you're an architect and you want to work out, let's say, what the volume contained in a reservoir is, then something like this is actually a very useful thing to enable you to do it. You want to know how high the retaining wall should be at the front end of your reservoir to contain 10,000 million gallons of water. Then a planimeter is a wonderful tool to help you to do it. It's not terribly accurate, but then you don't necessarily want accurate. It's a few percent accurate. But it was a wonderfully simple concept. It really is working out both the integral of the angle and the length, which gives you the area of the shape. Now, it was a successful thing, and lots of architects still have ones like this in wooden cabinets in their offices. Now, can you imagine in the future your son, daughter, or whatever having a wooden cabinet inside which is your dad's calculator? You can't imagine it, can you? But they did. And this thing is a piece of wonderful technology, and it's still valued and appreciated today. And as a concept, of course, that's what it now looks like. You can still buy them. They're using the same concept, but of course it's been enhanced by the use of electronics. Still approximate, just more accurate, 0.2% accurate in the order of, using the technologies which are available today. So this is a product which was right in 1856, and a product which is still right in 2016, but using a different mix of technologies. 1947, the baby computer, the concept of a general purpose stored program equation solving computer. This is what we now tend to think of as computer, and of course is a difference which the research community is leveraging painfully to explain how genetic computing and how anything to do with, let's say, quantum computing is going to be wonderful because it's going to replace digital computers. What it's not, they're not actually telling the truth is they're using the term computing as in solving an equation, not as in general purpose stored programming. There is a difference. But of course, in its day, they didn't implement that with transistors, not because they were just being bloody awkward. They didn't implement it in transistors because they weren't available. Valves were available, so they did it in valves. It demonstrated the concept, but the product wasn't viable in 1947. But of course, it was since about the 1960s. And in the 60s, the computer that was implemented was essentially just a product version of that. It wasn't trying to do anything else. It wasn't intended to be a smartphone or a TV or anything else like that. It was just being a computer. It was being a general purpose algorithm solving equation. 1947 to 1960, a mere 15 or 13 years. I mean, much, 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 much less than the 1,800 years of the earlier planetary calculator. And of course, it's been recurring the enhancements throughout that. Now, I think the thing that I wanted to emphasize in this is that implementations are limited at any stage by the available technologies. And the design engineer's role in any of these things is to use the optimal collection of technologies to deliver a product. So it's not just a case of could you do it, can you do it, but it's also to meet all of those other non-functional criteria which are important when it comes to calling this thing a product, because it's only when a product is associated with it that the cash flow starts to come back, that you actually get funding, you actually get recognition for your role in it. And the recognition that most of us get is not medals and accolades, knighthoods and things like that. It's a job. your reward for doing this thing is a regular regular salary. You get appreciated in that way. There's lots of problems with being appreciated in that way, and I'm not sure whether I get into it that in this particular talk. But one thing that we do know is that electronics has enhanced functionality again and again and again. We are just as guilty as the vast majority of people, incidentally, because we look at that and we recognize it as a computer. We look at that and we recognize it as a desktop computer. We recognize that as an organizer and that as some sort of laptop. You know, they have moved on a lot, but in some respects, you can say these are still the same thing. It's just that they look much sexier. You know, but it looks, that was pretty fast. Just didn't do all of this gooey stuff, you know. But we tend to trivialise it ourselves. Can you imagine then what the people as a whole, the world, the consumer community thinks? They don't see any technical advances inside those products. They just see them as presented more glossily, much more attractive.
The original computer is that lady, Babbitt.
That's right. She's the computer. Didn't I make that point? Mrs. Babbage. And of course the idea of computers moving into domains where they've never been before, of course, you know, automating your diary here. You know, a diary was a piece of paper. You know, your laptop was another piece of paper that you wrote on. These things are essentially all about enhancing some human itch. Anyway, 1965, the first date, my date was 1964. Gordon Moore's law was coined by Carver Mead in 1970 from an article that he wrote in 1965. So actually, Moore's law wasn't created by Gordon Moore, but it's created from an article that he wrote 5 years earlier. And he predicted that by 1975, which is the time now, of course, the other year, which is close to when I started in this industry, integrated circuits would be minimal cost and would contain around 65,000 transistors. Well, you know, that was a good start, and that's about roughly where I entered the game. But it was interesting to note that in 1965, he was designing integrated circuits with 80 transistors on it. And he was basing his observations on the two generations that have gone before, which was 30 and 40 transistors on it. So what does a 30 or 40 transistor circuit actually look like? Well, that's what it looks like. That was the EDA of the day. And that's what it looked like. That's 30 to 40 components. It's a quad two-input NAND gate. Well, they use it to stop the door flapping. Yeah, guessing stick is what they were called. And that's a photograph of mine. I still have it. So, and it's great to take it out and actually demonstrate that you can do calculations with it. And I have yet to change the battery, even once. So what can you say? So anyway, Moore's law, we're all familiar with this kind of thing, although me being rather perverse, I choose to use a version of this diagram which is dated 1999. Some may say, why do I do that? Because you've got lots of these diagrams from all sorts of places demonstrating Moore's law. Well, actually, this one came from the International Technology Roadmap for Silicon. And as far as I can see, marked the point at which they stopped drawing the red line. The red line is productivity. The blue line is number of transistors. And I've put some additional scales on there to give you some idea about it. And I'm not going to talk too much about the red line for the moment. I'll come back to it. And it's not so much of an act to extend that graph out to kind of today. And to see that when ARM was founded, we were talking about integrated circuits with around 1 million transistors on board. And that today we're talking about integrated circuits with around 20 billion transistors. Price has stayed about the same thing. But even if you just look at that, in the 25 years since ARM has been around, that's 20,000 times more transistors on an integrated circuit than when ARM was founded. 20,000 times. We know about Moore's law, but 20,000 times more transistors on an integrated circuit than there was just 25 years ago. And of course it's 10 times faster. which also means that if you're talking about the product of transistors and speed, which is not an unreasonable thing, that's 200,000 times more processing capability in that integrated circuit than when Arm was founded. You can't design something 200,000 times more capable using the same techniques that you were using at the time of the earlier, much more simple instance. You imagine if it was houses, you're building a house. It's the difference between building a house and building a fairly large village. You know, and there's all of the infrastructure and complications and logistics and methods. You're going to start using one design and repeating it all over and changing the colour schemes. And you know, there is differences in methodology between those two extremes which don't tend to get appreciated. Now the other thing is, this is just an example. It was NVIDIA's Tegra 3 processor. It was convenient because there was a die slot shot. It's around a billion transistors. And I just use it to illustrate, you know, a point. This is what three transistors look like. Well, actually, you can't see them. I'll give you a clue. They're there. Those are three transistors. There's a billion on this circuit, 1,000,000,000, 1/24th of the value put down on Arm in the recent acquisition. If each pound represented one transistor, then there's three of them, you know, okay? Now, the thing to note, though, is it's not the transistors which are the complexity in this. It's all of that other stuff sat on top of it. So the complexity of connecting up 80 transistors, 30 transistors for a two-input NAND gate, 30 devices for a two-input NAND gate, is not the issue in this circuit. The complexity is going up by an even greater factor. So probably, and it's difficult to put a number on this, but we may be talking about another increase in functionality, in complexity, which is created by multiple layers of metal and simply by the quantity of transistors on the die. We're talking about making things which is in the order of 20 million times more complex than when Arm was founded just 25 years ago. It's no wonder we've been busy. There's a lot of change been going on here. And yet we tend to think that things haven't changed very much. A few years ago, back in the 70s, this blue line was the leading technology. This is supercomputers, the mainframe. This fellow was pretty well the only way that you'd have got at electronics, state-of-the-art electronics back in those days. It was the driving force. People were using that to drive everything. Not surprisingly, it was for a professional application. Most people didn't have a supercomputer at home. You were lucky if you worked in an environment where there was one. Very lucky if you were probably going to be working for the government if you were going to be playing with something which amounted to a seriously front-end machine. Now, the market for mainframes hasn't gone away today. It's still there. And it's probably 3-4 times bigger than it ever was, but it's not the dominant markets anymore. These other computers, other forms of delivered electronics, if you will, have come in a series of waves over the years and displaced it. Now, and again, the mainframe was displaced, was overshadowed by the mini computer, subsequently by the personal computer, desktop interconnect, mobile interconnect, and of course Internet of Things. Everybody knows about Internet of Things. There is a less obvious thing is this vertical axis over on the right hand side, which is the change of driving force. At this end, it was technology for science. It was professional. At that end, it's technology for pleasure. It's consumer. Sorry, were you going to raise?
I was wondering, have you a version of this where the vertical axis is value? The vast number of units,
yes.
Okay, that you've got at the top,
yeah.
Is probably matched by the vast number that are actually in the mainframes as well.
Yeah, no.
That.
Yeah. I think with each one of these, the market has got order of 10 to 100 times bigger. The profit, the value per integrated circuit has probably gone down by a factor of 10 at that same time, but because the market has gone up by a factor of 100, the net revenue is greater. So you, each one of these, the margins has, have got smaller, and yet actually the volume has got bigger by a larger factor. So the revenue from each one of these is the ultimate determining factor, because the marketing people will lose interest in this one because this one has a higher value to them. But there are still some people who will find value in the mainframe business. There are still some people who will find value in the mini computer business because they're offering it in a particular kind of way, which, and then they're not necessarily the biggest companies, but they're big enough for what they want to address. The Internet of Things is interesting because when you cross that red line, it's the greater than 10 computers per person. Now, of course, you've probably got more than 10 computers per person on you as you're standing at the moment. You know, even your ARM machine has got a quad-core or more processor on board, and all of the peripherals frequently have another ARM processor on board. There are even some processors in there which are not ARM, but you know, if you've got a smartphone, you're approaching 10 today. But that's 10 per person in the world. So that will probably mean you, as a techie at the end of this, will be in the 100 computer domain, because you're going to be the extreme. But it's technology for pleasure. At this end, it was technology for science, for professionals. And one of the problems that we now face is we are still interested in this because this is the area which is mostly where we want to do research, because we're professionals and this is the exciting part. But actually, the market is not being led by us anymore. The market is being led by the consumer's insatiable demand for a glossy human interface, for being able to play games on their machine, for being able to have a display which goes right to the edge of the product, for sound quality which is marginally better than somebody else's. These are all not exciting from the point of view of the technologies. Yes, 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 it's a display, or yes, it's an earphone, or yes, it's an RF interface. But actually, from the consumer's point of view, it doesn't translate into that. It translates into the saleability of a product. Now, I want to move things into a little bit smaller time frame, because not all of this history has happened in my younger years. Some of it's been happening in your younger years. And this was, as I say, was originally aimed at a MSc audience. And so these are people who are older than 18 years old, but not that much. So they can see that this is something which has happened during their lifetime, which they're not necessarily even aware of, because it's so familiar that you don't notice it. But back in 1998, Canon, this is their top-end, prosumer, consumer, professional camera that a lot of people who were photographers would have aspired to. Excellent lens, fine mechanical mechanism, electromechanical exposure meeting, metal, kind of basic plastics, manual assembly, photochemical memory, like that. And also, we mustn't ignore this fella here, because this is a signaling processing element par excellence. It converts a 3D universe into a 2D plane and puts it on that photochemical memory. That is a huge processing challenge, and people tend to think, well, it's just a lens, you know, it's just film photography. Anyway, Canon made a very smart decision, and they decided that their value add was the camera. Kodak, you may remember them, made an absolutely stupid decision, and they decided that their value add was the film. The rest is written by history, but still, we now have in 2016 Canon, and they're still here with a very prosumer product. It's still a mechanism for enhancing human memory. It still has excellent lenses and displays. It still has precision forming of plastics and metals, much tidier looking altogether, much more modern looking. It's got a lot of stuff in it that it essentially didn't have before. It's got a computer, which just happens to be ARM-based, so it's a good illustration of something. Analog electronics, sensors and transducers, precision mechanics, micromotors, batteries, energy storage, LEDs and discharge tubes. A lot going on there, And that's still the same product. Essentially, the product is still the same. The company has incorporated an awful lot of stuff in those 18 years that it didn't have back then. Now, a perfectly reasonable question would be, well, of course, that's an ARM computer. Why couldn't ARM go into being a competitor to Canon? Why couldn't we take on the extra bits which make us into a camera manufacturer and do a lot of that? Because we knew that bit. We could do that bit well. Why was it easier for them to learn to use a computer than for us to acquire this other stuff? And that was a fundamental question which essentially says, these technologies may all be out there, but unless they're inside your company, ready to be used, the company can't use them. So Canon had to make investments in all of these things into getting them up to a product status to be able to be used to keep their major product lines alive. And they had to make that investment. Even though they were outside there in the units, but people knew about them, they had to bring them inside the company before they could include them in their cameras. And their company depended on those cameras getting out and working and costing and being manufacturable and all of the other stuff. Because again, it's fine having a wonderful looking camera, but if you can't make it, then you can't sell it. And so one of the things here, an additional feature, robot assembly. It's not in the camera, and yet the camera depends on it. That wasn't something which was part of the earlier camera. So that was something they had to design, and it isn't a part of the design of the camera. It's part of the environment around the camera. So the issue of designing then a camera has become not just designing what's inside the box, but designing what's around the box as well. So all of these technologies are available to all 21st century businesses today, but they have to be capabilities in a business before they can be used in that business's products. So what we've learned, I think, is that electronic systems are not just electronics. Electronics is still a fundamental element of this. We're talking about electronics, we're talking about manipulating an electron in a physical process. It's just that a transistor is a mechanism for doing that. Whether it's a MOS transistor or a bipolar device or a tunneling device or an electromagnetic device, these are all ways of making use of the characteristics of an atom.
Something about your previous slide, you said that you've got the camera and the environment in which it's made.
Yeah.
The two are not independent of one another.
Correct.
There are certain ways in which you can traditionally make the camera, which is simply not amenable to automation because it's too clumsy or because it takes too long. Or
yes.
It's just not the right way to do it. In the same way that you are sort of growing tea, that the way in which certain kinds of tea that you are picking is not suitable for automation. So in the same way, if we, from the society's end, say we want more predictable pieces of software or systems or the combination, it may be that however adventurous and innovative you may want it to be, that if it's not amenable to the verification tools to verify the properties, then you simply don't use them, however glamorous and exciting and technologically interested you may be. So you pick
absolutely
a restricted set of...
Graphene isn't on there, quantum computers are not in there, for very good reasons. They're not product ready. And so you're right. And if I was greatly excited by those working in the company, I would be very disappointed because I would be saying, what about quantum computing? We ought to be thinking about it. So yeah, think about it. But right now, we've got this camera to produce. I mean, even so, one of the things that I'm greatly impressed by here is called micromotors. They use piezoelectric vibration motors for doing the autofocusing on the lenses of these things. I mean, these are tiny. They vibrate a little bit, and they work their way around the ratchet. I mean, this is stuff which you really would have difficulty in assembling by hand. You couldn't have done it 10 years ago. You know, there is such a lot, such a breadth of technology, knowledge, experience, which has been incorporated in here. And as you're rightly saying, and as a design engineer who is responsible for designing this thing, there was choices to be made. What technology can I'd be sufficiently confident about that I can include in this product. Because I will have to predict the future here. I'm going to make a commitment to include that in the camera. If I do include it in the camera and it turns out not to be reliable or not available, everybody said it was going to be there but it isn't, you know, the company can be out of business very quickly.
Have you tried this on analysis with the motor industry?
No. Microelectronics industry is big enough for me.
In the sense that you've got a collision. Mm. You know, is it going to be Google that adds a car to their AI?
Yeah.
Or Ford who adds the electronics and AI to their cars?
Yes. Well, Jaguar Land Rover recently joined National Microelectronics Institute, NMI. Mm-hmm. And they joined because NMI changed the spec of their operation from being microelectronics to being electronic systems, because Jaguar Land Rover had recognized that the cars that they were making had stopped being mechanical and had started to be systems on wheels. So they, you know, that is something which has appeal. You know, I think people realized they were working on systems. They just hadn't realized that they were working on systems. It was so close to it that you didn't see it.
Can I just make a comment on that? Just about the Kodak issue. So it's not quite true. I mean, there's this concept that Kodak only did film and it didn't try doing cameras and therefore.
Oh, they did. They did try doing the cameras.
Exactly. Yeah. So it wasn't that they didn't try doing the cameras. It's when they did try doing the cameras, they made the wrong design choices.
Yes.
And therefore they failed.
Well, they left the decision effectively too late.
Exactly. But also it's because they have that ethos in the company.
Yes.
Of film. When they tried to make the design choices, they just, you know, they didn't make the right choices. Even at the last minute, if they'd made the right
And
choices.
Even when they were making the decision to go to digital cameras, they still had an awful lot of drag that said,
yes,
we're still in the film business, but let's do digital cameras as well, because they're kind of an interesting sideline.
But there's an enormous amount of patents.
Yes.
You know, 4,000 patents or so when you went in my boss. So they had the IP, it's just they made, as you said, it's... The philosophy made the wrong decision,
yes,
on the application, and that's what killed them.
There's a book out there that I would recommend that you all read, and it's a very readable book. It's Christiansen's The Innovator's Dilemma. And that's some wonderful examples of businesses who should have taken decisions in this direction. Some of them that did take the decisions in that direction and then were then dragged down by their history. So it's all of the reasons why effectively they couldn't innovate even though they wanted to, even though they knew they should. And it's wonderful examples of how what you are is a dead weight to what you want to be. But anyway, enough of that. It's a different story. Here we've got... The product that we're kind of all familiar, the smartphone. It has a lot of technologies. Most people just think of it as a phone. The technologies which are in there, most people don't even think of it as a collection of integrated circuits, but they tend to think of it as one. There's around 20 integrated circuits inside your average smartphone. There is also a lot of other stuff, like the embedded software. It doesn't count because it's not a physical component. ARM CPU doesn't really count because it's not a physical component, not the way we sell it anyway. The subsystems, micro machines, materials and uses. One thing I wanted to bring out here is inside of a product like this today, there is an awful lot of what I would call virtual components. The bill of materials, which tends to be used by people when they're talking about manufacturing industry, it's a list of all of the physical components that go inside that box. There is an awful lot, an increasing amount today of components which go inside that box which are not physical components, so they're virtual components. ARM is a virtual component provider. We provide something which is an important part of making that box work, and yet it isn't on the list of physical components which go in that box. We're not the only one. There is quite a lot of companies who are providing virtual components into this environment, but because they're not recognized in the production world, they tend to be ignored altogether in the political world. And political world, we can be dismissive of these things if we wish, but don't forget that the political guys are the ones who ultimately provide the funding which is researching your activities. So if they don't think that what you're doing is important, then they're inclined to save money on it, given half a chance. So it's important that we do start to push forward some of these concepts, because it's important to get over to Joe Public that what we're doing is serious. It is a part of this production line. It is a big global production line to produce these things, and the knowledge that we're contributing individually is part of this, and the UK is good at doing it. Now, the good news that has come out of the ARM acquisition is that for the first time ever, ARM has been the number one headline on the BBC. Nobody knows what ARM does, yet it was the number one headline. And the good, even better news was, because nobody knows what it does, there is actually a couple of follow-through articles on the BBC explaining what ARM did and how come it's worth $24 billion. It's good because it's got a message out to the population in general that they were doing something. We may not understand what it was, but actually they were doing something when it has value. Now, you can argue the to's and fro's on whether it's a good thing for the UK economy or whatever, but this, as a valuable way of connecting a message to the community, is something we've got to do more of. And it
suddenly became jewel of the crown, yes.
It suddenly became jewel of the crown. So in that list of virtual components is manufacturing. You know, how can you make something like this if you can't use robotic assembly and testing? How do you test something like this? It's certainly not an easy thing to test. The innovation is how you, as a designer, architect this system to utilize the best features of the available technologies to you in that business. You can't use the technologies which the water board has got. You can't use the technologies that the baking industry has got unless they're in your business. So you can only use the ones that you've got access to, which are really realistic enough to be used. Now, I'm going to come back to this one now, because the red line has been sitting quietly annoying some people. It should have been. And that is, this is productivity, and it became known briefly as the productivity gap, because when ARM came into existence, the amount of effort it took to design an integrated circuit was around 100 person years. But you could see from those gaps that the productivity improvement that was coming out of the EDA world was going to produce numbers which were simply unsustainable. 1,500, 8,500 person years on the productivity was just not sustainable. And then verification came along as a problem, which just made it even worse. Now, although those gaps were predicted, in many respects they never happened. And the reason they never happened was reuse. Reuse came in when that number became unsustainable. So in other words, there was a drive for using things which had been used before. Up till that time, and I can remember it quite clearly, everybody started with a clean sheet of paper. When your chip designed, you had a big sheet of paper, you had a logic template, and you started at the top right, left corner, and you worked your way down to the bottom right. That's how you did your chip design. But it was always a clean sheet design. After that time, you started to use teams of people. This was, in those days, I was a chip designer, I designed the chip. One. It became, by the time we got to ARM, it was something which small team had needed to be involved. So you had single designers, small teams, local teams, global teams. It was supported by the available technology, so the internet came along, the power of the personal computer and the desktop computer and the workstation enabled these large, more complex designs to be created, but subtly through that, we stopped being individual designers and started to be players in a team. The other thing was the reuse aspect. Clean sheet before, about 1990s, some reuse. Now, the interesting thing about the some reuse is that that coincides with ARM. ARM came in at about the time when reuse had started to become important. Reuse enabled you to, and ARM enabled you to not only reuse silicon design, but also reuse system design. The software aspect of it as well was something you could carry over from one design to another. You could use stacks or software utilities or operating systems or anything of that nature which people had already worked on, and it made your productivity much higher. Of course, we're now used to it, much higher level. Expertise reuse. We've now started to get to the point where we don't even have all of the expertise that we need in a certain company. We have to make use of expertise which resides outside the company. Now, that's still Arm, but it's a lot of other people as well. Not everything that's clever is known by Arm. There are some clever things which are known by other people as well, and they also contribute to the complexity of these designs. That smartphone, you know, that display and those capacitive touch sensors, which we're all so very familiar with, Arm knows nothing about those. I don't think that Apple knows a hell of a lot more about it either, but the LCD people do. And the people who are doing the contact displays, they know about it as well. How do you make those little piezoelectric transducers as good quality as they are? Well, I don't know, but somebody out there does. And when you're building a product like this, you're making use of expertise which is coming in from around the world in a way that never happened before. Without greater than 90%, and most people don't think of today hardly using reuse at all, and yet the reality is we're using probably 99% reuse in products today, and we're going to have to drive that even higher, because even 99% reuse is still thousands of or hundreds of man years of effort in producing your end product. And you still can't let that go out of hand, so you still have to keep using reuse. It also means that you've never got time to go back and do a job properly.
Life was not quite so different in the 1960s when I was in IBM, when hardware designers who really made it had managed to invent something that was good enough to go into the library.
Right.
And you tried to build a computer out of all of these pre-designed devices that were already there for you, which you were reusing. And I can't remember the numbers now, but I think it was something like 80 or 90% of a new computer would be able to be built out of essentially recently designed standard parts. Well, being reused everywhere.
Since Newton's days, we've been building on the shoulders of giants. And I think that that's where we tend to think only in terms of this area, which has been important. But it goes right back, you know, to the caveman days, the guy who discovered that you bang two stones together, you make fire, you know, and then the guy who realized that you break stones and you end up with something sharp. You know, other people knew that you could break stones and end up with being sharp. They didn't have to reinvent it all the time. I mean, it may be excessively boring relative to today, but, you know, but things like cement, things like plaster, these are wonderful technologies. You know, how would we manage without cement? And yet nobody thinks about the chemical processes that go on in cement. Well, actually, some people do, but we don't have to. We just mix water and stir it up, put a bit of metal in it, and you've got a building. You know, it's kind of easy. Somebody invented that. So this is really only relates to this specific area that's been happening during my life related to microelectronic systems. But it is interesting to note then that from the 90s, designer productivity was the thing that was driving the methodology. We knew about logic, but what we needed to do was to get people being more productive. And the only way to realize those was by reuse, hardware and software methods and tools. I mean, things like synthesis is a reuse technology. Writing in HDLs is a reuse technology. These are all enabling you to use what went before and take it forward into the next design. Clean sheet approaches are several orders of magnitude more expensive, which essentially means that for most applications, they're just too expensive. Even military applications these days, who will be the last bastion of that bottom blue line, the people who are searching the highest performance for their computers, for their simulations, will have to use technologies which are heavily based on commercial end product design. Check the press recently. The processor of use by Fujitsu for their next supercomputer is Arm. That's commercial technology, okay, and it's flowing through to the very highest performance processors which people are designing today. It's an unfortunate fact, as I say, the perfect processes, the best opportunities are unaffordable because of the volumes of electronic systems which are shipped to the commercial market. So this is what the ARM story is about. A very simple processor, a RISC machine. You could have gone to the textbooks back in the 90s and seen examples of this. There was nothing particularly wonderful about it. The idea of creating it as a module that was usable inside a chip, as opposed to a chip in its own right, Lego brick-like, was the clever bit. And it wasn't the technology of doing it that was the clever bit. It was the business model of doing it that was the clever bit. The thing that sold here, that implementation, that's what a simple first processor with an ARM 7 core and some other things looked like and a bus. It was never a success, but it illustrated the principle. The principle, though, was that ARM at that time were able to license a CPU, and you say, you put around it all of the things that you want to put around it to make it into a product. You don't sell it like IBM, like Intel was selling it as a chip. This is the chip. This is how you put it in together in a system. We know about systems. You don't. We were saying, here's a CPU. You know, put it into your system. Use it how you want. It's up to you entirely. We're not going to teach you about it. If you want to make a successful product out of it, you know what that product is. You know more about that than we do. But if you need a processor in it, why not use ARM? It's not that much of a differentiating factor. And in fact, it isn't a huge differentiating factor, but what it is a huge support logistics issue. That simple ARM 7 core was, I don't know what, 50,000 transistors, something like that. Our top-end cores are around 50 million transistors today, but we still maintain the whole family. Simple one has a single core, more complex one has a suite of cores. Some of them with DSPs as well. You also need 24 of them then in a family now, not just that one simple core. And you also need a methodology for hanging them all together. I mean, this is 4 quad core instances there of CPUs, and over here 4 DSPs. I mean, those are a lot of processing power, and this is a typical system integration prototype that we ship with people who are going to buy ARM systems. They want to know how to implement a system. So here we are, a big synthesis or a big network ready to be synthesized of probably the most complex system you're ever going to need. Take out the bits that you don't want, synthesize what's left. Reconfigure it, use it as the basis. It's open to you when you buy it, this is it. But it handles things like debug, it handles things like communications, it handles things like support from operating systems, all of which are productivity vehicles again. So what you do find then is that although the thing we ship is just notionally CPUs and GPUs, there is a hell of a lot of other stuff as well. That is very much the tip of an iceberg. And it's keeping all of that other thing working as an entity, which is an important thing that people undervalue when they think it will be an easy thing to do to replace ARM with another free open software core, for example. Because unless it has all of that, then it isn't a solution in a product context. It isn't reliable. And one of the things that's a big part of this is the ability to have a roadmap into the future. So we make a big thing about involving our partners in the technology evolution for our CPUs and our systems, because they need to know that having invested in their first generation of product, that they will be able to take most of that into their next generation of product, and most of that into the generation afterwards. You've got an open source CPU, you don't know anything about what's going to happen in the future. Reuse is a major part of your future. Well connected into the remaining parts of the life cycle is also important. This is a product at the end of the day, if it's going to be successful. It's not just good enough to say, well, our bit works. You know, you've got to have that connection to the system, because it's only when the system sells, when that baby at the end of the day is on the shelves in PC world and selling in millions, then that's when we start to get revenue back down. It's our business model that works that way. But it also reflects on people like yourselves. if we have got technology from the university relationships, then we value the university relationships. We want to put more into encouraging those relationships. It all does genuinely flow down. But we do have thousands of partners, millions of developers effectively working on utilizing ARM. Of course, they're not doing it for ARM, they're doing it for themselves. They're doing it for their own business reasons. But training becomes a major issue. We're little ARM, 4,000 people big worldwide, and everybody is talking about ARM. There are people out there who want to do courses based on it, they want to do lab work based on it, they want to do research based on it. We haven't got an education group which is big enough to support all of the people who are interested in this, so we essentially have to take the same approach as well and allow people to develop their own course material, to authorize it, to support it, to indeed take course material that other people prepare and present it on their behalf through ARM's websites and so on. You might take a look in the Lab in a Box is a scheme which is an interesting one, because this is actually it's very, very real in a box, because the components come from different places. So the little embed devices here, they've got an NXP microcontroller on it. It's assembled by a company out of China who pay for them. The Keel software is part of the ARM software. An awful lot of the manuals and presentation material are produced by universities, and they've decided to open source them. So we effectively are acting literally as the people who put this, collect it together and put the stuff in a box. But it's the idea of getting everybody involved in it, is getting a value out of being involved in it. Our business model, I said it's important that you realize when you're talking about making a business, that ARM wasn't the technology of the CPU wasn't really that exciting. What was exciting was the business model. Essentially, it was the two-part business model, that we have a licensing and we have a royalty base. So the licensing is give us some money up front, which is a bit more like direct purchase. But the royalty one was turned out to have been very interesting, because the royalty one is a share of success. So we can say to people, we don't want too much money from you up front, as long as we have a share of your success. So we might have a higher percentage of royalty from some companies with a smaller percentage up front licensing. Other companies may want to pay everything up front in a license and then not pay anything in royalties. But the royalty one turned out to be very important, as I say, because we have skin in the game, then it matters if we get their product out. So it matters to us if the end product worked. Now, it does mean, however, that it takes 2 or 3 years to develop a product. It takes 2 or 3 years for a partner to include that in their chip design, and it takes time again before that is going to be in a product. But the product may ship for 20 years. Even today, products are going to be shipping for 20 years. We still have ARM CPU products out there delivering royalty today, and ARM 7 products, which are the first CPUs that we produced, and they're still delivering royalties today. They're going through merges. So they are having new cases put on the outside of them, but basically the inside content is still the same. Those are genuine products. Those are examples of reuse. 15 billion ARMs were shipped last year. 15 billion. We don't make any. What's the population of the world? That's 2 for everybody in the world. So we enable a hell of a lot of industries, and interestingly, those are surprising new entries. The IoT stuff was perhaps a little bit more predictable. Most of the IoT stuff which is out there today is ARM-powered. That's small processors and simple processors and low-power devices. But it really became quite a surprise to us when our partners decided that it would be a good thing to do to take that technology, our technology, and use it in servers and in HPC. We don't tell our customers what they can and can't do. They buy from us rights to make certain things, and if they've paid the money, they've got the rights to do what they want with it. Now, they do come back to us and say, well, if it had this extra feature, then it would actually be better suited to our servers or our HPC applications. And so, you know, we do architectural tweaks to suit them. And these are, obviously, they have to be marketable tweaks, because we want to sell that thing to several people afterwards as a concept. But we do get that. And now we have trust with those people, then they do tell us about their product roadmaps, and that's important, because they also know that we're not going to leak those product roadmaps to other people who are also licensees of ARM technology. And that only comes by years. 75 billion, it said. That's how many we've shipped altogether since day one.
Given that your product is virtual,
yes,
presumably it's at more danger from cybercrime than physical wars.
Well, again, it depends what you mean by cybercrime.
How many people in China are bothering to pay you money?
Oh, well, okay, this is piracy.
Yeah, piracy.
Okay, well, cybercrime, I'm thinking of tax, but piracy. Well, we do get actually perfectly good royalty payments from people who are using ARM technology in China. And one of the attractions is because of that link into the infrastructure. If you've got a business and you're making a complex product, it matters that the product works. And, okay, ARM is moderately expensive. It's not the cheapest IP on the block. But the satisfaction you get out of, you know, it's ARM, it's tied into that infrastructure, there is track record of doing similar things, there is this future path, and there is the tie-in to the software environment and the support from the reuse. You can, if your product doesn't need that, go and use an open source CPU. But actually, a lot of the Chinese companies need it too. They may be Chinese, but it doesn't mean they're poor quality. And so they are quite happy to pay up, and they do give us the royalty. Now, the interesting thing was, I said, some people choose to have an entire license money up front and no royalties, but our licensees always ask people to report on the numbers shipped, even if the royalty due is zero. So we do get reported figures from China, for example, of shipped CPUs that we have licensed to them. So they have no interest in not giving us that information. So actually, in some respects, China is more open in that regard. So here I am then at the finishing line, and electronics today is much changed. I think you can see that. But design fundamentally is still the same. It's about making electronic-based stuff happen. Electronics design has evolved really into electronic system design. I think everybody must appreciate that. It's not just about the chip anymore or about the personal transistors in a radio. Electronic designer has to consider, optimize all sorts of wider system technologies today as part of delivering that effective product. But could my education have prepared me for this? Well, actually, I think the answer was surprisingly yes. That the thing that it did that really turned out to be valuable was it excited me. And it gave me a language to communicate with. When I went out into the world, I could go into a conference room and there were people talking in that conference room, and I came out of that conference room with a little bit more knowledge than when I went in. If I'd gone into that room and didn't understand what anybody was talking about, I'd have gone out with a little bit less knowledge than when I went in. So it was a net positive thing. That language thing is hugely important, it turns out. And the other one was it taught me how to work in a team and to be scientific in my approach. It's like to be working in a team, you've not got to mind being wrong. You've not got to mind standing up and telling people what you think. And if people tell you, that's rubbish, you're not going to take it personally. You know, because we're all trying to achieve this thing, whatever that thing is. And that team and the scientific approach turns out to have been one of the most important things that I learned. The rest of it, sure.
I have a question about the yes answer that you put in. The language, it's about the languages you mentioned. Do you think the number of vocabulary items and the language that you had in 1965 and the number of words that is contained in today's language as such, is there any change in between these two at all? And what sort of initiatives we should take? to accommodate this new language?
Well, sorry, it's not a new language in the sense of C or HTML.
No,
right, good. We're talking about the, you know, as an electronic engineer, what did I need to understand when I went into a room of more experienced engineers? What was the language which was being talked around the table? Is it different? Yes, it's different. Is it more complex? I don't know it is, because products were never easy. I mean, the whole reason you employed an engineer to do something rather than a technician was it wasn't easy, whatever it was that you were trying to do. And so you had to overcome problems. An awful lot of the difficulty of overcoming problems is understanding them enough to express them, and then to express them to people who can help you identify a solution. Now, that process needs language. It needs syntax, it needs all of the other things associated with a language. But in essence, I don't think it's fundamentally more difficult, because I'm still the same human. Arguably, my brain is less powerful than it was, and I can still understand some of these things. So I don't think it is fundamentally more difficult. I think we are able to apply hierarchy to this thing. The other part of it is the through-life learning. Because the language that I had here is different to the language that I have here. I can still understand some of that language, although I haven't used it. You know, e to the minus t over cr is one of those things which comes to me from distant past. It's the time constant equation, isn't it? I know it's in there. I can't remember the last time I used it. And the other one is 1 over 2 pi root lc equals resonant frequency. I mean, they're somewhere back there. they got burned into my brain. I can't think of the last time that would have been relevant in a meeting.
Would it be the case, Ian, that sort of usage of those things would be more common in the past for the engineers, the same sort of...
No, it's just that...
...or then today?
It's just that was part of the thing I needed to know to be reasonably credible when I went out into the world at that time. Because I didn't know what I was going to do. I had a training which included RF, it included analog, and yet I went into digital. And yet digital in those days was kind of analog-y anyway. But the stuff that I had learned enabled me to do what would have been called in university computer science. But it wasn't computer science when we were doing it here. We were making an electronic telephone exchange. You know, designing a chip, it wasn't a computer. The RF part that I learned, I don't suppose I've honestly used since I was in university. It's not entirely gone, and from time to time the breadth of my knowledge is useful in a modern meeting. Somebody will say, you know, I don't know anything about that, and you can think, actually I do know something about that, so you can contribute something to the meeting. But essentially when I came out I had a broader knowledge, but not the depth of knowledge to be really more than just about viable, survive in my first meeting, survive in my first job. And as soon as I had that job, then I was going to build up the experience around that specific related technology associated with that job. The other parts of it, they're going to decay a little bit. But I could have gone into RF design. I nearly had a job with Plessy Templecombe, and they were doing sonar, which is actually pretty close to our low RF, the way they were doing it, 60 kilohertz stuff. That would have taken me much more into the analog sphere than into the digital sphere. It was toss a coin. Which one did I fancy? Actually, I chose to go away from the military applications towards the civil. That was just a decision I took. I had the two job hops. Now, if I'd gone that way, maybe I wouldn't have been here today. I don't know. I may have gone a different, you know, my career may have gone a different way. But that was a choice that I made. The language that I had at that time would have enabled me to have survived in both of those scenarios. I mean, a few years out, could I have gone into an RF group and been credible? Probably not. Because they've all advanced in that 2 or 3 years. I haven't. I've stagnated in that particular area. I've developed in another area, but it's not an area which is relevant to them anymore. You know, so this is a live scenario. I think the through life learning is the important point about this, because you don't come out of university an engineer. you come out of university on the first rung of a ladder, and you then got to keep climbing that ladder. And the idea is, be responsible about that. You know, my design engineering experience has 3 to 5 years lifetime, as far as I can see. There's a lot of stuff which is still there. It's not gone away entirely, just like those CPU markets. They're still there, but I've got to acquire around 50% of new stuff every two to three years. That has to be managed, and it's not really managed today. You know, that's who you are. The role that I present to people is essentially based around the last few years of work that I've been doing, and it always has been. And that, so I can stagnate if I want to at any time. This is a race. I might get fed up with it. It's hard work, but it's hard work you enjoy doing. And because you enjoy doing it, you go home and you read the magazines, and you do sit in front of the computer a little bit longer than you should do, and you do struggle to try and understand what that menu item means or how this optimization works, or, you know, those are the things that, because it's exciting, you go and do it. But there is some ways out, and that's the other thing too. I want to scare people in some respect. I want to scare students and say, you know, it's not just a case of knuckle up, keep at it, 2 or 3 years now, and then you'll be made for the rest of your life. It's sit back with your feet on your desk. It's not like that. But there is some opportunities along the way for you to get out. This is a race, but you may not always want to keep doing it. And you can go cross-discipline. You can get out into the administrative, into the project management, into the other less bleeding-edge opportunities. They are there. And actually, skilled engineers and scientists, they make very good architects and accountants and other business legal people. They have the right kind of minds. So there's plenty of ways, once you get some experience under your belt, if the scientific and engineering route turns out not to be for you, then there are plenty of ways out. And that learning that you'll have done will turn out to be valuable learning. So it's a wonderfully exciting path to stay in. Not everybody gets grey hairs and still smiles. All right, I still smile. How are we doing for time? Anybody got any limits? All right. Oh, these are just a few back end slides. I'm not really intending to blow by blow through them, but you know, people talk about Arm being a technology company. Therefore, of course, the only people that Arm will need to employ are people who are technology people. Well, the answer is, you know, no, we're a business. We've got lots of people involved in lots of things. You know, this is how we acquire people. This electrical, electronics, computer science, physics, maths, non-technical subjects. These are all parts of a modern business. You know, you don't have to be a STEM graduate to be employable by Arm. You don't have to be a microelectronics graduate to be employed by Arm. There are lots of jobs. Our CFO did history. Chief Financial Officer did history. You know, it's the what we've got. Company Secretary is a lawyer and General Counsel who was a chemist. You know, these are. My career, leaving school with no qualifications, turns out to be not that unique, because these are people who've done serious career changes along the way. I've stuck with electronics, but that was because, you know, having pissed around a little bit in the earlier years, I then thought, well, this is something which is going to interest me, and stuck with it. But businesses need a diversity of skills. Technology businesses need a predominance of technology skills, yes. But it's not necessarily just computer scientists or microelectronic designers or physicists or chemists or, you know, there is roles for lots of people. The thing about it, of course, with all of these things is you want to sell your skills to a company that needs them. Because, you know, if I am a lawyer going and getting a job sweeping floors or going and getting a job in a bakery, you know, the qualifications and the efforts I've put into being a lawyer are not being exploited. And the same thing applies here. You want to go and get yourself a PhD in microelectronics of some aspect, tiny branch of it, and you then go and get a job with a company that doesn't need that, you know, you might as well have saved your time. Go and do it another way. The actual bit of paper doesn't matter in industry. What matters is how well you're able to do the job. And that's the job you've been employed for, or the job that you have evolved business into. I'm not going to go through this, but this is something that I worked through a little while ago, and I worked through it because I was troubled with an early conversation that I had with my grandson. He was, I don't know, 4 or 5 at the time, and he was referring to his sister, who's 3 years older. And he came to me practically in tears one day, and he said, "I don't know nothing." We went to a wildlife park in Australia. Somebody had asked, "Have you ever patted a koala before?" And little Jack turned to his sister and he said, "Have I ever patted a koala, Carrie?" And this is just like, you know, my sister knows everything. She would know if I've ever patted a koala. But it just made me think that there is a time when everybody seems to know more than you. And in fact, they do. You know, when you're that young, you start off by knowing nothing, and everybody and everything knows more about it than you do. And gradually, you move to a position where, you know, you're an expert in something, but you're still amateurs in other areas. You know, most of the engineers and scientists are socially naive, inept. You know, we're great at what we do, but we're actually pretty poor at that interfacing to the ordinary people. And there's definitely an us and them that comes in there. But we mustn't underestimate the value of this, you know. But here is a teach. I mean, we're getting up to a point here where you know as much about most things as most people do. You know, it's average. You move to a little bit further where you might start to know a bit more about some things than most people do. And it's at that point that you start to be valuable. Because you know more things about some things than most people do, especially if those skills are needed. And then you move into this expert region. It's interesting now in the expert region because you're learning from experience from your peers, and they're learning from you. It becomes a bidirectional thing, whereas previously it's been inward. And at that point it starts to be both ways. And of course, you become highly valuable in that area as long as what you know is appropriate. So if business needs it, then they'll pay you a lot for it. And if they don't need it, they won't pay for it at all. So maintenance of our professional values is an important part of our professional lives. I hope that's come out, if nothing else. The other one is, we are talking about elitism here. It's not a popular thing to talk about. But if you're a weightlifter, you know, your biology matters. I think it was Steve Redgrave, who was the rower, was interviewed by the BBC after winning gold in some Olympics a few years ago. And he said, for all of those budding rowers out there, please can you give us some hints and tips that might be handy for them? And he said, yes, certainly. He said, the first thing is you've got to choose your parents very carefully. And I like that because, you know, if you're a weightlifter, then it matters, doesn't it, that you come from the right shape stock. But that for some reason, we have this idea that what goes on between your ears isn't a muscle, you know, and that there isn't a genetic link in there. But I think we've really got to start saying, you know, there is a genetic link in there, and we've got to realise that, like all other muscles, this muscle between your ears can be developed. If it's the right shape to start with, it helps. Around 3% of the population has an engineering degree. Only around half of that number is actually employed in an engineering or scientific role. That means around one person in the top secondary education class is a geek. That's the geek. That's the one in the class. That's probably you all were geeks in your respective classes. I know I was. It's not fun being a geek. It's even less fun being a female geek, as far as I can see. It's a difficult place to be a geek. But I think that we all have to recognise that that's part of it. And if we're going to educate people, that we've got to recognise that those geeks have to be encouraged, not just laughed at. Around 1% of them will make world-class leaders. So we're now talking very small numbers. But they have huge benefit. You know, these are senior people with lots of experience.
Talking about that gender issue you put out there, on open days we had a few female aspirants who wanted to be as an identity university. They actually asked
Yeah.
how How do you see female engineer out there in the academia or in the industry? And you know, if you're
doesn't figure. That's right.
It's a different thing altogether. But yeah.
I think it's difficult in school. I think it's less difficult in industry. In professional industry, it may very well be in the less professional industries, it's still kind of fashionable to be, you know, more masculine or whatever. But I think in the sort of environments that we're working, you don't see gender in that sense. It's people contributing. And if they're a contributor, they're a contributor. It doesn't matter what colour they are or what their background is or anything else like that.
At this much earlier stage, this is where they're not developing.
That's right.
Because they're regarded by their peer pressures as geeks.
They're geeks. They want
twice.
You're under you're under pressure to be average here. To conform. They call it the was it the tall poppy in Japan, don't they?
The school teachers can actually encourage the whether it is male or female, can encourage them to become you know, this 1% valuable 1% of this nation.
I think you've got the way that you do that is by making society value geeks. Now, not make fun of them. So we're not just talking about Big Bang Theory or the IT crowd. You know, we're talking about people really realizing these geeks are actually the future of our economy. They're going to drive it. They're going to do all sorts of roles in this, but they're fundamental to us having this successful economy. These guys have to be encouraged. They need their muscles developing. They need the equivalent of a stadium built for them to practice on, and they need to have the opportunities to go out there and meet the other world leaders and talk about stuff that society won't understand, but because it's going to coach and develop them. Now, I don't think this favouring the already favoured is a very popular thing to be presenting, but nevertheless, I think it's still true. You know, we should realise that these are not a huge number of people, yet their potential for impacting the economy is huge, actually. There you go. So does Arm have a problem recruiting? No. Could we? Yes. Visibility is our major problem. Though most people in this room will know what Arm is, go out into the outer world, surprisingly most people don't. No idea at all. Good news about the BBC then, Arm's been taken over. The society as a whole has realised that there is a kind of company out there about which we knew nothing, which is worth £24 billion. Blow me, that's a big number. What were these guys doing? Now, we should be capitalising on that wave. I predict that 1 week from now, nobody will know what Arm was doing. Nobody will know anything more about the technology. We've got to capitalise on it. We've got to keep that wave rolling. And actually, we have got to be doing it. It's nobody else who can do this. It's not our major day job, but we are nevertheless need to do it. Okay, I'm not going to talk too much about that. ESCO, interestingly, said there are 30,000 electronic system enterprises in the UK. 30,000, employing 850,000 people. This is a big activity already. If you talk about the careers opportunities of electronic systems in the UK, most people would say there aren't any. There's no opportunity here for electronic systems. That's all done in Japan or America or whatever. It says on the back of my phone, designed in California, manufactured in China. Manufacturing is in China, design is in America. That's the story, political story. We've got to do something to correct that. That information is really important information. But politicians don't like not understanding. And so they have to admit that there is a business out there which they don't understand, and yet it's still valuable.
Yeah, I don't want to stir political stuff here.
Yes, you do.
How would that number sustain if we had the Brexit in place?
I don't know. I mean, these are businesses who have sustainable models. There is one company I can give you an example of. It's a company called Moretech down in Plymouth, because I'm a mentor of Moretech. They're growing. They're an SME. They started 15-ish years ago, and they've grown quietly. And they're CMOS analog designers. That's their speciality. And they design analog blocks for SoC devices being used around the world. So these phones, chips, the analog circuits in them have got a sporting chance of being designed by Moretech in Plymouth. They are recruiting hard at the moment, and they have no problem justifying that. They have problems in finding the people. But they are currently at 20 some odd heads down there, and they're planning on doubling it to 50 plus this year. Because most of their customers are outside the UK, doesn't really matter, they're outside Europe as well. So I don't think Brexit is going to affect them as an example at all. There is another company I know that specialises in EDA tools. I can't think of their name for the moment. The use of EDA tools. So they do synthesis, layout and verification. That's all. But they're a specialist in that. They have specific knowledge of one tool chain optimised. They get used by companies all around the world because they can do a good job of it, because they can do it fast, and because they can handle the complex systems. And they're very good at doing it. And they have offices in, I think they probably employ around 50 people at the moment, but they are in UK, States and India. So it's, you know, these are companies. Brexit's kind of irritating, but it's not going to fundamentally change anything. And there's a lot of companies like that. I only know a few.
Funnily enough, European companies, they're all, well, maybe not all German, but French companies, we know they're all heavily subsidized.
Yeah. These guys are essentially ignored.
These guys, they're not subsidized.
Yeah, they're ignored. Industry, the political world doesn't know they exist. And I think that because they're difficult to understand, it now knows they exist, but doesn't want to be influenced by it. In fact, the general reaction to the ESCO report was, oh, well, if that community is doing as well as it is doing, then we should just leave it alone. Education, education, education. We require a two-pronged approach, society and individuals. So individuals have got to learn that this is not a once-and-for-all education, it's a through life. But society has got to learn to value the roles. We have to help society to do that. You know, we all have a day job, we all have an ordinary family out there. I should have realised the writing was on the wall. When I took my first job after university, I was designing telephone integrated circuits. And I came home one night and my wife with our young baby had been to a mother's meeting in the local village, and she came back and she said, "What is it that you do?" So I said, "Well, I'm designing telephone." "Okay, right." So that was all she wanted to know for the time being. Anyway, a week went by, and she said, "But we've already got a telephone." And that said it to me, of course. It was always going to be a problem explaining to my family what I do for a living. But my family are an example of the rest of the world. You know, they were, if you like, they were special because they were prepared to listen to me while I told them what I did. But actually I didn't. I didn't even bother too much there because it was too complicated. But we have to get to the rest of the world somehow. So, conclusions. There is an end to this. Electronics today is certainly not what it was in 1974. But the other good news is 2016 is not any kind of stagnation point. I think the next 40 years are going to be just as exciting. And probably the 40 years after that. History has been like this since the Stone Age. We've been doing this thing, and it's going to continue to be challenging. And the role of the electronic design engineer, is still going to be what it always was. Basically, to come up with a commercially compelling product. That's all you're trying to do. Using the available technologies, it's up to you to find out what the available technologies are and to be innovative in how you put them together to create a solution which is commercially compelling. The design engineer has to architect to implement viable and timely products. That's all. Simple. Just keep doing it. Team, far more a part of the design activity these days than it had been. But actually, maybe there's a change, maybe there's a cyclic thing here. because these days you can do IoT type products leveraging heavily on systems which are already designed, or components and subsystems which are already designed, which essentially means that all you're doing is a relatively small system integration task. So maybe we're starting to see a cyclic thing here, where there are big teams involved in creating objects, but the objects enable small teams to develop complex products. So that, you know, it might be something that we're going through, that teams actually may start to be coming back down again. You carve your own shape. You carve it through your professional life. And I chose the word carve because it's not a passive thing. You have to think about the route you take through your life. You have to shape yourself to exploit the opportunities that emerge. And if you don't, you're going to fall by the wayside. The higher education is definitely a good starting point, but it's not a forever thing. If you're going to be a doctor, maybe it's enough. But if you want to be in this exciting career with a lot of change going on, then you need to be actively involved in carving your own shape from now all the way through till the end of time. At which point I will stop. Yes, there is an end to this. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much.